Samuel 15, 22, when Samuel listens to Saul's rationalizing, he then says this and puts it all in clear terms. In 1 Samuel 15, 22, then Samuel says, "Has the Lord as great a delight in burnt offerings as sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams." To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. Now, we tend to see that quite naturally as a set of priorities being set up here, which it is. But I want you to take a different twist with me this morning on this and look at it as a term of balance. See, one thing, Samuel, he brought out two elements, right? Obey and sacrifice. And he didn't discard either one of them. Obey needed to be in the equation, and sacrifice needed to be in the equation. It was a question of ratio. It was a question of balance. But there needed to be a balance between the two things, obedience and sacrifice. Obedience and sacrifice. And Saul missed the whole balance thing. He was very unbalanced in what he was doing. Now, looking at these two words, it's important for us to realize something. There is a broader meaning to them in the context of God than simply obey and sacrifice. You can use obey in a lot of ways. You can say to your child, "Obey me," and this is whatever I say you better do no matter what. You know, somebody wants you to obey them, it could be that they're your oppressor. Obey in itself is kind of a gentle word, and the same with sacrifice. There's a lot of things that can be considered a sacrifice. It's just kind of depriving yourself. Is every deprivation a good thing, though? But when it's in context with God, they take on far bigger meanings. Far bigger meanings in these words. Let's just start with the sacrifice side of it, since that was really the big pitfall, the big fall for Saul. Another word for sacrifice in this broader spectrum of things might be what I use as the word religion. And I mean that in a universal term. There's all kinds of religions in the world, all kinds of religion. So, you know, what exactly is religion? I know as we did and we had more time to converse back and forth in the first service, people came up with a lot of good elements that are in any religion that we have. But let me just throw this up for you to chew on a little bit. Religion, in the general sense, is a system and a mindset by which humanity approaches whatever they consider divine. It's our way of responding to the divine. It's how the beliefs are set up, the system of thinking. It's how we physically respond, what things we practice, what ceremonies. All of these things are involved in a religion. And it happens in here. You came this morning expecting things to happen in a certain way. There has to be a kind of a protocol to follow. Otherwise, you know, we would all be in confusion. So religion is that kind of thing. It is even our reasoning put into words. There is the Quran. There is the Bible. There are the old Jewish scriptures. There are all kinds of things that are how we understand God, how we understand the divine put down into words. And I'm talking religion in general. A religion, it is this construct. It is a moral and spiritual construct. If our spiritual or our moral system was a physical body, religion would be the skeleton. It would be the bone on which everything attaches. It would be the structure, the thing that's rigid and gives it form. Well, if that's religion, if that's a construct, what would obedience? We'll get into that more, but think of the obedience side of it as the flexible living tissue, and we'll get into that more. But in Saul's time, as we looked at his religion, and Saul was a religious king, the construct of Judaism is sacrifice. It's based around sacrifice. Sacrifices had to be given in order to approach the divine. Sacrifice was that bone on which everything kind of lay. So technically, if you're just a religious Hebrew, Saul's really technically in his right. He got and he brought back the first fruits of their war. He brought back animals that were the best of what they had, and he was going to offer them in sacrifice. So it fit within the framework of his religiousness. It fit into the religion of things. Now, this is, don't get us wrong. We need religion. We can't just simply say, throw out all religion. You know, maybe you were one of those people, I know I was at one time, and said, I'm not religious, I just love Jesus. It sounds good, but it's not reality. Because if I love Jesus, I must have a system by which I can approach and interact with him, and that system is going to be my religion. Now, it depends how I use it, where I get it, but I need a physical way, a structure to approach God. So religion is a necessary thing. We need the structure. We need the order. We need things to practice. We need something we can be anchored on. Otherwise, it's just drifting. It won't last. And it'll just be chaos. Trouble is, if it's all religion, even if it's the one true God, even if it's the one true God, the right thought on divinity, even if it is, if I do nothing but mimic the actions of God and never understand the intent behind them, I am going to be very superficial, and I'm probably going to be very hostile. Because I understand God wants me to move this way and this way and this way, and I'm going to judge everyone else to see if they're moving the same way. Are you moving? Are you doing those actions that God wants you to do? And probably be judgmental on that part. If we are simply religious, we are well-dressed corpses, is what we become. We are lifeless. If it's all structure, we become an institution. And institutions aren't living things. And it's not what the church is. Well, okay, that's getting way off on nothing but religion. Well, how about the other side? What then would obedience be the bigger side of? Well, obedience is more than that mindless subservience. Even when that word came out of the prophet Samuel's mouth, the word was Shema. And Shema has, among other meanings, something very interesting. It means to hear intelligently. To hear intelligently. In other words, to obey God, if I were to put it in more of my modern thinking, I would say to obey God is for your mind and God's mind to be in sync. And like your heart and God's heart to be in sync. Maybe the expression would be on the same page. There's a connection going on there. And it's not just doing something, it's like feeling and understanding why such an action or whatever is going on. Can that actually happen? Does that actually happen? Well, according to our religion, in our words, 1 Corinthians 2:10, and just summarizing through, it says, but God has revealed his hidden wisdom to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, just even the deep things of God. The deep things, not just the superficial actions. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we may know the things that God has freely given to us. We have the mind of Christ. And in mind, we're not just talking an understanding of the intellectual, we're talking the feelings of Christ, the emotions of Christ, the value of Christ, the nature of Christ, the personality of Christ. We have his personality within us. Now, if religion is that rigid part of the spiritual walk, it's that bone, obedience then is that flexible living tissue. Obedience is the direct relationship. Obedience is a living personal connection that goes on in that way. For Saul, for example, religion said sacrifice animals. Religion says sacrifice animals. But obedience says, but not these animals. These animals are from an evil place. And they're revolting to a holy heart. And if you have a personal connection, they're revolting to you. Religion in itself didn't make the distinction. It didn't have the connection of God's personality in there. it made a big difference whether it was all religion or if obedience was in the balance. Saul was all about religion, and he knew nothing about personal connection and all of that. He didn't understand God, and it was the imbalance that caused his fall. All that God had promised him, and it was torn away from him like the tear of a robe. And what's worse, just like that robe, it wasn't so much God tore it away, he tore it away from himself. Imbalance can be a very, very destructive thing. To obey is better than sacrifice. To heed than the fat of rams. To obey is better than sacrifice. And to heed than the fat of rams. And four key words in there. Four key words that teach you balance in this issue. We looked at obey, the Shema word, and I said it meant to listen intelligently, but to listen intelligently also implies something else, to listen, as they would say, causatively. In other words, you are told something, you know it's a wise thing, and therefore your actions are caused by that, what you heard. Don't put your hand on the stove. Well, that sounds like good advice. I'll think about it while I'm leaning on the stove. You know? No, it said you act on the words. That's what it means to obey. Sacrifice, zebach in the original, a slaughter, by implication, a sacrifice offering. Notice this, is that a sacrifice in itself does not give life. Religion in itself does not give life. A sacrifice, in fact, costs life. It's just in the context of God, in this sacrifice, it brought great value to where it was aimed. There was a lot of value in the sacrifice. There's a lot of value in the blood that was spilled to atone. There is value in sacrifice. He, it was the word kashab, to give attention or regard. I like the primitive or the literal meaning came from to prick the ear. Now, I don't know how stern some of you parents are, but maybe if you call, or maybe you, if you the child wasn't listening and you kind of did this thing, you said, okay, can you hear me now? You know, you had the ear. And that's the thing we're looking at, the heat is, depending on how hard they were twisting, you were really listening. Yeah, I hear you. And this idea, and that's the idea behind heed. It means to listen intently, to listen intently, to heed. And then the word fat, like fat is kind of a bad word in our day. We think of fat as, calories and heart attacks and all of that stuff. But fat, the word that was being used here, dealt with the best of the best. It was the sirloin, it was the filet mignon, it was the best part of the animal that was being sacrificed. So in all of this, and I'm just going to confess that my computer here decided to do something, and Satan got in it for a minute, but it got him out, let's just go to that. If you take all these meanings and you put them down into what Samuel is telling us in terms for us today, it would probably be like this. To listen intelligently is better than expending life. And to give regard to what God says is better than the choicest part of the best part of your sacrifice. He's not nullifying either one. There is a time that you must give. There is a time for duty. There is a time for structure. And it is in ratio, though, to the personal side of the connection. One gives you structure, the other brings life to the structure. Put it in modern terms, in this balance of obey and sacrifice, and how does it play out? Well, for me, I tried to picture in my head those things that I've experienced, seeing whatever, as things unbalanced, and what it looks like. And to me, you may have your own things you put in here, if the unbalance leans towards the religious side, somebody is just religious, in the sense we're talking about, they will probably tend to see a relationship with God as something that is simply sacrificial. It's all sacrifice. Even if you're doing the same things, and you see it, to come on a Sunday morning is, I sacrificed my time this morning to come and do my homage to God. It was my duty to God. Sacrificial that way that If it's fun, it's got to be wrong, you know. If you're having a good time in some way, that's got to be just wrong, because God's stuff is always sacrificial. If it's painful, it's probably from God. You know? Some people, really, that's what it comes down to. Why don't you follow what God wants you? I don't want to sacrifice that much. It's got to be painful. It's got to be depriving me of things. And so sacrificial leans towards that. It's probably someone with a very strict protocol of behavior. If you come to church, you act in a certain churchy way, and you wear your churchy clothes, and you talk in your churchy words. And if you're really religious, and even when you go out, then you talk to other people all the time in churchy words. And it's just this very, very strict protocol. See, the problem is, if we see religion, it's wonderful as order, and it's wonderful if we have strong doctrine. That's important. But if we're too big on the sacrifice side in our mentality, it tends to work this way. God, I've sacrificed, so you owe me. You owe me. Now, it may depend. It usually will play out for people something like this. Since God owes you, when people owe you, you call in favors. I haven't missed a Sunday in a year, God, so please let me not have this terrible disease that seems to be over me. And when God doesn't, in the moment, answer that prayer, and you have to go through hard things, then you either become indifferent or angry with God, because God owes you. He owes you. So it tends to make you go that way. Now, if we talk on the obedience side, and of course, it's a whole lot of obeying to the sacrifice. It's a whole lot of personal connection to the religious structure. But it is still possible to unbalance in that direction. Some things that come up with people on that side might be the personal connection is everything. Your personal connection. Sometimes I even kind of grit my teeth a little bit with that. Christ is my personal Savior. That's true. But in the unbalance, and I believe in our culture it tends to, because we're a very me-oriented culture. God is my personal Savior, my personal sugar daddy, my personal Santa. It's me and God. Everything is me and God. Well, if everything is you and God, then you tend to move towards saying, why do I need to be in with all these other people? It's me and God. That's the real stuff. I can go in a field, on a golf course, in the woods, wherever, and I can worship God there. Because it's personal, and my understanding is personal, and that's all that really matters. But the thing is, if we look through Scripture, we find out that the whole thing is there's a collective side to what God is doing. But we don't see that if we're tied up in totally on the personal side of it. Yes, there is the personal side. But newsflash, salvation isn't all about you. If we look at what Scripture says, God's plan of salvation is for a race of beings called human. And God's answers aren't really too concerned about the immediate, although He does answer in the immediate, only as it pertains to the eternal. God's not too concerned about you stubbing your toe, but He's real worried about your eternal existence, your eternal welfare. Not the single person, but the race. Not the moment, but eternity. That's the balance of things. So I just wanted to share with you three immediate steps. Three simple things in this thing towards balance in this regard of religion and personal experience. One, dig into Scripture. You can't balance what you don't know. If you don't know what's on the scales, you can't balance it. So you need to know God's Word in the first place. Two, spend time before God. The saying is true. There's no substitute for time. Spend time before God. Call it what you want. Meditation, quiet time, reflection, whatever. But there needs to be a time that once you know the words, they have to be processed. Until they become part of you, there's nothing there to balance either. You hear intelligently. You hear causatively. You put it to use. You become sensitive, and it's a skill at the prompting of God. It's just not something you just naturally are able to do. It takes time to learn it. Know the Word of God, then know the heart of God. And last but not least is this, trust. Trust God to be right. Trust God to be right. You say, well, I'm sitting here, and, you know, I believe in God, so naturally I believe God's right. Well, do you really? Do I really? As I look at how it played out in my life, how many times have you struggled against what God was trying to do in your life? How many times have you tried to snatch back the control of what was going on from God? How many times did you doubt how He was going to work this out if you trusted in Him? We all do it. It's human nature. So trusting in itself is an objective. Trusting in itself is something to learn how to do. But if we'll do those three things, if we'll make it an objective to balance, obey, and sacrifice, we can avoid stumbling, at least in this area. And if we don't, there's the big one. If you say it doesn't sound like it's worth it, it's not a question, will you stumble? It's just a question of when.